Remember, you got the bell. I'm gonna throw it to you, and remember, you know how it works. Okay.
All right. Pretend I know what I'm doing.
You ready?
No. I, unlike you, still get stage fright.
Come on, you gotta get pumped up.
I was pumped up, and then you hit. Then you said go, and we're like, and we're done being pumped up. Now we're just.
Nah. Okay. Ready? One, two.
Let's go. Turn up the volume. The volume. From the basement of the Empire State. This is the Basement Surge.
3, 2, 1. Welcome back to the Basement Surge. You know, I have another co-host here today. My wife Heather has joined me for an awesome new series that we're starting here on The Surge. It's all about conspiracies. It's all about things that the general population are paranoid about.
Yes.
All right, so they're part of our everyday sky, the white lines known as contrails that follow airplanes above. To scientists, these lines are nothing more than water vapor and exhaust, but to conspiracy theorists, there's something much more sinister. Now, I said contrails in the intro because there are two different specifications when it comes to these things. So there's chemtrails and there's contrails. So we'll go over both. We'll talk about both. But in the meantime, if you are watching this over on YouTube, don't forget to hit that subscribe button, give us a thumbs up, and babe?
Ring that bell!
That's right. Ring the bell for all future notifications of whenever we drop new episodes on over on YouTube. But if you are listening on a podcast listening app, please don't forget to hit that follow button, hit that like button, hit whatever button you have to hit in order to get updates on new episodes of the podcast. All right. So contrails, chemtrails. Okay. They're totally two different things. Okay. So now I have a bunch of notes here because I have come prepared. Okay.
I'm so very proud of you. If you have watched any of the Basement Surge material, you know they are the most unprepared people you will know.
Yes. Yeah. And you know what? We like to be spontaneous.
It makes them them.
Okay, so contrails, I'm going to read this in my notes because I wrote this down here. Contrails are condensation trails or vapor trails, streams of clouds sometimes observed behind an airplane flying in clear, cold, humid air. A contrail forms when water vapor produced by the combustion of fuel in airplane engines condenses upon soot particles of sulfur aerosols in the plane's exhaust. When the ambient relative humidity is high, the resulting ice crystals plume may last several hours. So it's a result of exhaust.
Right.
Okay, because like a car, okay, airplanes have exhaust.
Right.
Which is...
That's how they go.
That's how they go because it's a combustion engine. Mm-hmm. So it's running on fuel, which goes boom, boom in the engine. And then there's got to be some byproduct. There has to be something that comes out. Like cars have exhaust.
Right.
Okay. So right. It's the same thing. But chemtrails, okay, chemtrails are a result of introducing chemicals into these trails. Now, there are certain specific times when chemicals would be used in a chemtrail.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, but I don't know. Like it really seems like really nefarious. It seems really like, I don't know, like the government's trying to hide something. So
our government hiding something from us? I can't even. Can't even.
Chemtrails have been around for a long time. I mean, mm-hmm. You know, we were doing research for this the past couple days, you know, and you and I have been comparing notes. And it seems that we've been looking at the same websites.
Right. great minds think alike.
Yeah, because, she comes down here and you know, she sees all these notes that I wrote, and she's like, yeah, I got the same thing. I got the same thing. So we're basically watching and reading the same articles and videos. Yesterday, or was it earlier today, you know, I came up to you and we were talking about the chemtrails, and basically you had said something about how they've been around. They haven't been around for a while. Mm-hmm. And, you know, and then I recently found out that the trails can be seen in photographs dating back to World War II. So, which is understandable, because I would think that the trails would be more prominent back then, because the engines were so much bigger and so primitive.
Right. Right. Yeah, I get where you're going with that. I can't get the words out either, but like, I know what you mean. You know, it's kind of like the old cars. They had more exhaust fumes in their cars nowadays, dude, because we've learned how to fix these problems.
Yeah.
So,
like the last time we were at the gas station as a family, okay, like you could smell the gas and you can smell the exhaust from all the cars, you know? And I remember how big of a deal the kids made how bad the exhaust smelled.
Right.
You know, and I like the smell of the exhaust from cars. And I remember when I was a kid, the exhaust from the cars smelled a lot different than they do now.
Yeah. But yeah, so but then that's a different thing, because that is a contrail. That's not a chemtrail.
Right.
That's just a normal thing that comes from a plant you're not going to get rid of,
yeah.
You know, until the days that we start using, you know, vegetable oil in the planes, you know.
Or electric. Electric. Yeah. Electric planes.
We'll get into that, because if you have electric planes, you need like, it's the whole process of electricity. I'll get into that one later. But yeah, so basically the conspiracy theory is that the white trails are a cocktail of dangerous chemicals sprayed from planes in a plot to control the population, food supply, sterilization.
Yeah, there are
all kinds of weather.
There are a couple of different reasons. I found actually a definition of the conspiracy, okay, online, where it says, in the 1990s, a popular conspiracy theory arose claiming that long-lasting contrails contain chemtrails, okay, that were sprayed by governments for purposes such as controlling the weather or dispersing drugs to influence general population. Mm-hmm. So there are a couple of different reasons why the government would include chemicals in the chemtrails.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, so like I just said, you know, weather, controlling the weather, dispersing of drugs. So they have four main reasons,
right,
about why the government would try to control. Okay, so you have sterilization, reduction of life expectancy, mind control, and weather control, climate control. Mm-hmm. So sterilization, I don't know so much about that. You know, I don't believe that would be one of their reasons. You know, I mean, sterilization could lead to population control.
It could, but I haven't really seen a decrease in people not being able to have kids. I feel like that's been pretty stable.
Yeah. Unless they're just not releasing the numbers on that.
Also, because, you know, back in the old days before they had all the, you know, contraceptives and birth controls, a lot of people had more children. Now the average is a 2 or 3.
Yeah.
So it's not even that they're sterile, just that we just have less kids because we can.
No, because it's true that back in the 60s and the 70s, people had bigger families.
They did, because,
you know,
they 50s, had
60s and 70s, you know.
Right.
It was common for people to have 3, 4, or 5 children.
Right.
But nowadays, people are even like dwindling that down to maybe 1 or 2,
mm-hmm.
you know. And so I don't really think that it's the government's fault.
No.
You know, so maybe in another conspiracy, but not in this one.
Not in this one. But now the other thing going with the population is that it is a concern, because we are living a lot longer than we used to.
Yeah.
In the 1860s, the life expectancy was 39 years old. Now it's 78. So that's a big difference.
Yeah.
So we live longer, we're using more resources, we're taking up more room, and yet we're having more babies, which is why a lot of us are having, you know, the great grandparents who are seeing our kids.
Yeah.
You know, that wasn't a thing back then. Yeah. And now it is. So I could see the government being worried about, are we running out of space? Are we worried about this? So not that I'm condoning it at all. Not at all. I'm just saying that that may be one of the reasons why they would do something like this.
Yeah, people are living longer now. That we're running out of space. We're running out of resources. You know, gas, what, a barrel of gas is, what, $115 now? It used to be like 37 or something like that.
Minus the Ukraine war going on.
Yeah, minus all that stuff.
But even before that, it was too much.
Yeah, yeah. But yeah, I mean, we're running out of resources. We're running out of room to build. You know, I mean, there are still areas of the world that are just jungle and, you know, forest area and haven't really been touched by humans. But at the same time, it's like, where are we going to go? You know, we have no choice but to move into those areas.
I've seen the Discovery Channel. I'm not going to the jungle. Everything can kill you. It's not happening.
You don't want to move the family to the jungle?
No. We are not Tarzan. No, we don't do
no,
it.
No. But yeah, I mean, and nowadays people are living long enough to see their great grandkids.
Yeah.
And yeah, you know, I've never met my great grandmother.
Well, my kids had a great grandmother. My grandmother was still alive for a long time.
Yeah.
So yeah.
Well, maybe it's starting at our kids' generation.
Yeah.
You know, so I mean, who knows? But the next one is mind control. So mind control, to me,
I'm excited about this one.
Seems a little iffy because I don't know exactly how that works, but Heather has some information on that one.
So I really, really hope that I can explain this well enough to get.
Because this is pretty scientific, right?
It's pretty scientific. Yeah. I mean, it's got big words. Bear with me. Okay. So as far as them using the chemical as mind control, Barack Obama invested in the BRAIN Initiative, which stands for the Brain Research Through Advancing Innovative Neurotechnologies. We'll get through this. Basically, they are looking for ways to treat, prevent, and cure diseases such as Alzheimer's, schizophrenia, autism, and traumatic brain injury.
Okay.
So
sounds like a good
and it sounds initiative. Like a great thing. And yeah. I would love, considering that both my grandparents got Alzheimer's and dementia, and I would never wish on anybody. So the idea that they would be finding cures for this and ways to fix it is great.
Yeah.
But behind, like, every government thing, behind every good thing, there is a bad reason for it. So what they are saying is that by doing this research and learning how our electrons work and our neurons go together and it changes our mood and this, they can use it to control us as far as our anger. We can be told to do things without realizing that we're being told to do them.
Yeah.
We could, you know, all of a sudden be...
It changes the brain chemistry.
Right. Like you can go from a lefty to a righty real fast.
Wow.
Which could be bad, either matter which side you're on. But and the way that works is you need all that to form. And the best way they did it was by using the chemicals as a vehicle to implant in a way that would otherwise be found more difficult. So by them dropping them from the sky and then us breathing them in and them getting in our nose and our ears and everything, then they would go in our brain and we would...
Yeah, we'd inhale it.
And now it wouldn't just take one time, take a couple times of getting it going, sure. And then they'd have whatever they want.
Wow. I mean, I did read a couple articles saying that some of the chemicals that they could use within the chemtrails could, like, turn us docile, you know, mm-hmm. like relax us or just, you know, just change our way of thinking.
Right.
You know, and it's a little disturbing because who's going to stop them?
Exactly.
You know, like you,
we're not going to be able to.
And there's nothing you could do to prevent it. Like, let's say they do it. You know, you can't just stay in your house and, you know, be
protected.
Right,
it'll get through the walls. So, it'll eventually have to go out. It'll eventually come in.
Yeah.
But yeah, it's scary to think that, you know, our president's been funding this and investing in it and encouraging it. Meanwhile, we're like, yes, right. And then it could be something really bad. Well, like, that's really scary to think of.
Is there any evidence to say that he actually included these things, these drugs into chemtrails, or is this just a program he's working on and people think that, you know, that's what he did?
Well, it's kind of like he hasn't said, I'm putting chemicals in the chemtrails to
right, okay,
be mind control.
Yeah.
But the technology they're using,
it's there, right?
And there have actually been 23 mind control technologies patented in the U.S. since 1950.
Yeah, the U.S. government is huge on mind control.
Like
MK Ultra. Look that one up.
There should be a limit as of what they can do. Yeah. So there may be some truth to that. As far as, I mean, it makes sense. You need to get a little itty-bitty probes into a bunch of people at once. Save money. Don't do surgery. Just kind of
drop it from the sky.
Look at the pretty plane, Mom.
Yeah. People who are trained, they can see the difference between a contrail and a chemtrail.
Well, honestly, even people who aren't scientific, I can look at them and say there's something different there.
Right. You know, and so what I'm going to do is I'm going to put up a picture right now of comparing the two side by side and labeled which one's which.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, so... So
what they say the difference is that the contrails, which is a normal, natural thing that the planes release, dissipates within a few minutes, where the chemtrails take a few hours, and they are a lot thicker.
Right. Okay. The last thing that they say that these chemtrails can be used for is weather control and climate control. Okay, so now I was watching... Joe Rogan had somebody on that called Mick West, and he was talking about how chemtrails and all the whole conspiracy, not just chemtrails, but everything, like all conspiracies, how people can get sucked into them.
Absolutely.
You know, because you look something up on YouTube and you can just get sucked in, you know, like go right down the YouTube rabbit hole, and YouTube will keep showing you video upon video of all conspiracy
theories. You become brainwashed.
Right, you really do. But he was saying, and I'll read this from what he said. He said that the power elite of the country believe that the chemtrails are their last ditch effort to maintain power before the entire world collapses into chaos. Okay. He also said that they think it's a desperate situation. They feel like the end of the world is near and there's about to be this environmental disaster, and chemtrails are the only thing holding the world together. Okay, so he believes that the chemtrails, number one, were created by the world elite, all the corporations, all the big corporations, all the people in power, whoever actually run the company, that's not the president.
Right.
Company, the country. That's
the ones above the president.
Yeah, the ones above the president. But he believes that they created the chemtrails in order to stifle and keep the world together from climate control. Because I don't remember whether it was back in the 80s or the 90s that Bob Dole was huge into climate change.
Mm-hmm.
And he was trying to convince everybody that, you know, climate change is happening, and nobody was listening to him. And I guess, you know, this was the response, because I don't remember seeing chemtrails before the 90s, I want to say.
Right.
You know, but they were obviously around since World War II. But, you know, with Bob Dole and everybody else talking about climate change, you know, chemtrails kind of came to the forefront, you know, and everybody started talking about chemtrails. And I'm thinking that this guy, Mick West, who was on Joe Rogan, you know, I'm thinking he's onto something, you know, because maybe, you know, these chemtrails are keeping the climate where it should be.
Well, so that's one thing that I kind of agree with as well, because climate can, it's not just rain, it's also the hurricanes, the tornadoes, the all the really bad storms that we, yes, part of the world has seen a lot more, but I know we have not had a good thunderstorm in a long time. Whereas I remember as a kid constantly looking out the window at the thunderstorms and seeing all the big lightning, all that. It was like a lot more.
Yeah.
And we don't have that now.
No.
Which isn't necessarily a bad thing because we don't have trees falling on houses. We don't have trees falling on cars. We don't have tornadoes destroying entire places. Yeah. So it's kind of like if they were doing it, I almost, as long as it's not for population control, but if it's for weather control, you know, I get the idea, and I would applaud that almost because that'd be really smart.
Yeah. So now, okay, so let's get into this where the government was actually asked about the chemtrails and what their response was. So their response to the chemtrails was that the chemtrail hoax has been investigated and refuted by many established and accredited universities, scientific organizations, and major media publications. That's all they had to say about it.
So it turns out there was 77 scientists that did a survey to check the soils and the areas around for any chemicals.
Right.
Out of 77, 76 said, no, there's none.
Yeah.
I want to talk to number 77.
Yeah. Number 77 actually believed that the government was involved in the chemtrails.
Right. Like, I want to see his field notes.
Yeah. Absolutely.
Because I'm down. All right.
Because the EPA said the same thing.
It's just hard for me to believe that the government scientists found no evidence of the government mingling in things. It's just kind of like, can I have my own people in there? You know, it's just. And that's the frustrating thing is that we're never going to know the answer until someone's on their deathbed ready to confess.
Yeah. Well, that study that you just spoke about was by the Carnegie Institution for Science, okay, back in 2016. And, you know, they were asked if they were uncovered any possible evidence of government-run chemtrails operation throughout their study. Mm-hmm. You know, and like you said, 76 of 77 scientists said no.
Right.
But, like, what did that 77th scientist find?
Right.
You know, and all 76, the rest of them, the 76 of them, they had to have known what number 77 found.
Right. Because they had to find it too.
Yeah. So, but all 76 of them said, okay, well, you know, no, let's just dismiss it. Come on. Something's fishy.
You know what? If I have an opportunity to be like, tell the truth or have the black guys, the guys in the black suits come with me, I saw nothing.
Yeah.
I saw nothing. Yeah. I reported nothing.
I didn't see anything. I'm sorry.
I will never make it an interrogation. No. I will crack.
They'll come and hit you, the men in black, with that pen, the button, you know, the flash.
Yeah. So it's interesting. So there's this group called Bye Bye Blue Sky, and their purpose is to raise awareness of the chemtrails. And they're quoted saying that 20 to 30 years ago, we never saw these trails from the planes.
But
so
they were wrong.
Well, the thing is that 20 to 30 years ago, I was young enough where I don't remember if I did or not because I was so young. So
right.
I think anyone who is over the age of
50,
if you can remember, did you guys ever see any of the white trails coming off the planes? I know there wasn't as many planes as there are now, but you had to have seen, there were some. So did you guys see the trails or is this new?
Yeah. I mean, that's a good point.
Yeah. I would have been like 4 or 5 years old, so I wouldn't remember if I did or not.
Right. You know, and but there are pictures from World War II, like I said, you know.
But can you, right, but pictures can be altered, pictures can be changed. You look at the encyclopedia.
Look at the moon landing.
You look at Antarctica. You look up Antarctica in the encyclopedia.
Oh, we will be covering Antarctica on this show.
You
Thank
know,
you. Yes.
So
we will be covering Antarctica.
Pictures can either tell 1,000 things or tell you 1,000 lies.
Yeah. Okay, so let's talk a little bit about seeding.
Okay, so seeding. This is the legal.
Right.
We know is happening.
Yeah.
Chemtrails.
Right. And I think that this has to go, seeding has more to do with weather manipulation.
Right.
Than mind control.
Right.
So seeding is basically when an airplane is rigged with a dispersal machine to release these chemicals into the air around, not inside, because I found that out. They don't go in the cloud.
No.
They go around it.
Right.
They go either under it or on top of it. And they release these chemicals into the air, and the cloud sucks them up and creates water.
Well, doesn't so what happens is basically, so they're not trying, they're not making rain. They're helping the rain fall. So sometimes the in the cloud, the rain particles are just kind of swooshing through each other. They're not combining. And when they, so to make the rain, they have to combine and make a big thing get heavy enough to fall. And if they're not doing that, we can go up there with stuff like what they make dry ice with. So solids from a solid form of carbon dioxide, silver fluoride, and sodium chloride. That's the things that they use to do this. So it is similar to the particles that are already up there, and they see that and they form around it, and we make rain.
Right. So, okay, so a good example of this was China. Mm-hmm. China seeded clouds ahead of the 2008 Beijing Olympics, creating rain in other parts of the country so that the stadium would stay dry.
Right.
You know, that's manipulation. That's weather manipulation. You know, why can't they, you know, make it rain in other parts of the country, like when California had those fires?
Because you can't make rain that's not already there. You need to have a cloud already ready, and that cloud has to have enough rain particles in it in order for it to work. Otherwise we'd be, you know, there'd be no more forest fires, there'd be no more drought, but we can't do that. We can only work with what we already have. So we're just enhancing it. But the reason that we are doing the seeding is because nowadays we use a lot more hydroelectricity. So the dams are running water, and the water makes electricity. And if we don't have enough water to feed the need of it, then we don't have electricity, and we have to. So the electricity we use in the hydro is only like a backup. We use that, and then if we run out of that, we use actual electricity, which costs a lot of money. So to save money, they want as much water as possible. So we go in and we add a little more water, and then we have more free electricity versus having to use the stuff you pay for.
Yeah.
Other places that we use it, Argentina uses it because they have a lot of wineries there, and the hail storms kill their crops. So you go up there before the hail comes down, and you, instead of being hail, you time it right so it becomes rain or snow. I don't think it snows in Argentina. No. But so rain, sorry, rain instead of hail, and then the crops are saved.
So, I was looking a little bit into this, and cloud seeding is actually common.
Very.
You know, a lot of places do it. They do it in Texas, for instance, you know, where there's a lot of storms, a lot of thunderstorms. Mm-hmm. And I found out that the county that the people live in actually pay for it.
Mm-hmm.
You know, so it's like an option that your county can opt into, you know, to say, okay, yeah, let's do it or let's not do it. But let's say that, you know, your county opts in to do it, then the seeder, they call them seeders.
Mm-hmm.
The seeder basically gets his orders from the weatherman, from the meteorologist. And he tells him, right, I need you to hit this cloud over here, you know, and he flies out and, you know, drops the chemicals, you know, and it makes rain. Now, and depending on how much of the chemical he drops depends how strong it rains.
Right. It's very scientific. They have a specific amount they do.
Yeah.
Not amount. They always have the same amount, but it's how many times.
Right.
So someone that can go up there 2 or 3 times a week, some can go up once a week.
See, I don't, these chemtrails, it's like, yes, okay, they are exhaust from the plane.
Well,
contrails
are just, it's not even the exhaust. I mean, it's a condensation coming off of the exhaust,
right.
And it's get, and then because it's so cold up there, it makes the cloud.
Yeah, I found out that planes, they normally fly in negative 40 degrees.
Right. So it freezes.
So the heat from the engine coming off the back of the engine, mm-hmm. you know, mixes with that cold air and then creates the contrails.
Right.
You know, but the chemtrails is totally different, and a lot of people get them confused.
They do.
You know, because they see smoke and trails coming out of a plane, they just say, "All right, well, that must be chemtrails," mm-hmm. but who knows? I mean, it could be. And you don't see pilots coming out of the shadows saying, yeah, we're secretly dropping chemicals.
Well, they're not going to. I mean, that's just it. The people that are doing it, I mean, their jobs are based off this. And it's not just every plane. So the plane that you take from here to Georgia isn't going to be the same plane that's doing this. These are planes that are jets. They are U.S.
Like military planes?
They're military planes. They are crop planes. They are specific. So
yeah, but
it's
I'm
not
sure that,
every single plane.
I'm sure the regular Boeing planes that everybody takes can be outfitted to...
It could be. It'd be a great cover-up to put them in planes that everyone is going in all the time. But mostly they're talking about the government planes. And the government planes are not going to come up and say, yes, we're doing it. You know? But now, see, now this is the other thing that we have to realize is, yes, it's good to control the rain because then we can get more electricity, which is green. So it's good for the earth. It's good not using all electricity, less power. It's good. But, okay, we're starting with the rain. What's next? And then you have the playing God problem where if we're going to keep controlling the rain and the weather, then it's going to eventually backfire on us.
Right. Do you think it's kind of like, you know, the same situation where if you take Motrin every day, your body just gets used to it and it doesn't work anymore? So if they keep doing it like all the time, the earth will just get used to it and it won't work anymore. We'll have to think of something else.
Well, yeah. I mean, I think it's just kind of like it's going to cause, I mean, if we're making it rain when it's not supposed to and then it does rain.
Yeah.
We're going to get more flooding.
Right.
It may change the atmosphere up there to where we're not getting enough rain.
Yeah.
You know, there may be more droughts instead of flooding. More droughts mean more fires, which means more, a lot of things that can go wrong with that. So it's really, we have to be really careful as to how far we go. And we have shown through history that we cannot be responsible with technology because we make nukes, we make bombs, we make all kinds of diseases by accident. We make, we are just not good. So now we have a technology that's, let's change the weather. This will work out great. They don't intend for it to go wrong. But it's just when you start playing God, it happens.
It's a byproduct.
Yeah.
Something's going to go wrong.
It is, because then someone's going to want this power. They're going to want this technology. They're going to want this, and it just turns into a mess.
Yeah.
And if this chemical doesn't work, let's try a stronger chemical and a cheaper chemical.
Which could lead to sterilization.
Right.
Yeah.
And plus, they're telling us they're using dry ice and sodium chloride. They're not going to, but they may be adding.
They could be lying.
They could be lying to us.
Everybody could just be lying. Covering it up. Pilots don't say anything.
Bastards.
Maybe the pilots don't even know.
They may not.
Yeah.
I mean, you're putting gas. I'm putting gas. Well, no, because, well, yeah, maybe.
They don't put their gas in the planes.
Someone else puts the gas in the plane.
Yeah. Okay, so a couple of the famous people who actually believe that chemtrails is a real thing. Who's your favorite on the list?
Kylie Jenner. You know, when the Kardashians say it's true, it's golden.
Yeah.
That's it. It's when the Jenners get involved, I mean, they know it.
Hey, they got O.J. Simpson off.
It's very true.
We'll talk about that in another episode.
And then there was my favorite one, Prince.
Yeah,
Prince. But, you know, I liked Prince. Shh. Pretend he didn't say that. I'm not a fan. Shush.
Sorry.
Anyway. But Prince, talked about this on one of the on a talk show one time, and he believed it was true because he noticed there's an increase anger in people, and the world was getting angrier and meaner, and he believed it had to do with the chemicals and the mind control. And he said this way like long ago, like in the
long before he died.
Yeah, this was like really long.
You know, so it's not even the reason why he died.
Because he told people? You think it was a conspiracy that they was killed? Don't get me started. I will be hunting some people down.
All right, so let's wrap this up. So now through every episode, every one of these conspiracy episodes, we're going to talk about the conspiracy, and then we're going to categorize it into one of three categories, okay? It's either debunked, it might be, could be, or it's actually legit. Okay, so where do you stand?
I think it is plausible. I think it is. It is.
You think it's a could be?
I think it's a could be.
Okay. All right. Why?
Because the technology is there. Mm-hmm. Because we wouldn't think twice of it. We see planes every day, so it would be a good way to hide it. And I can see the reasons, if these reasons were the reason, a lot of reasons, why the government would do something like that.
Yeah.
Like, it just seems like something they would do, shady like that.
Yeah. You know, I'm on the cusp of could be and legit.
Okay.
Okay, like, I really think that, yeah, this is happening.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. I want to say maybe 50-50 of each. I'm like right in the middle. Okay. Because like you said, yeah, we have the technology to do it. Okay. And I think especially in recent years, the government is getting more brazen. They're getting more brave and trying these experiments with the population. So I think that it is plausible that something is going on.
Right.
Okay. Not so much maybe back in the 70s, 80s, and 90s, but more so today, that, you know, we're more preoccupied with other things that are happening in the world.
The government's really good at that, where they're like, this is, you start realizing this is happening. They're like, look at this shiny thing over here. Look over here.
So I am like right in the middle between could be and legit. Mm-hmm. Okay. That's where I stand. This was fun.
It was.
Yeah, I can't wait to do more episodes. So these episodes, these conspiracy episodes, will be dropped every Friday. Our normal episodes will be dropped on Mondays. So we're now up to 2 episodes a week, everybody. If you love The Surge, do me a favor, hit that subscribe button, hit the follow button, do whatever you have to get notifications, because we got a lot to talk about.
We got some good ones, and I love that it's not the normal ones you've all heard about.
Yeah, yeah, we're trying to go away from the normal conspiracies, you know, like the moon landing, you know, like it's just the off the beat ones that nobody's really heard of, and a couple of good ones, you know, a couple of well known ones, but we'll sneak them in there. But all right, everybody, thank you for joining me. Thank you for joining us. Sorry. We'll see you next time.
Let's go. Turn up the volume. The volume. From the basement of the Empire State. This is the Basement Surge. 3, 2, 1.